Hello learners, I welcome you all in yet another video lesson of D.El.Ed program course code 509, unit 9, Assessment in Social Sciences on Assessment Indicators in Social Science at Upper Primary Level. But before moving on to the topic, let me share with you the proposed flow of the lesson. In the beginning, I would share with you the lesson guide and then the expectation in terms of learning objectives. We will discuss about the methods of assessment which are available in social sciences. We will also discuss about the assessment indicators in social sciences. We will recapitulate at the end and there would be a take-home task. So, first of all, let me share with you the lesson guide. During the presentation, I will explain and exemplify the different concepts. You should follow my voice and the slides as well. You will find important words and sentences, etc., have been highlighted to facilitate retention. I have also summarized the main points at the end to have a quick glance for better retention. Then there are some questions and exercises in between and at the end of my presentation. You are advised to attempt these questions or exercises after going through this video lesson. Now, let me share with you the learning objectives. After the completion of this video lesson, you would be able to know the different methods of assessment in social sciences. You are going to get information of assessment indicators in social science and you are also going to get acquainted with the abilities associated with each of the activities reflecting the abilities. Now, there is a situation I am posing to you. A teacher who teaches social sciences wonders, after the implementation of continuous and comprehensive evaluation, what are the different mechanisms through which she can assess the performance of her or his student in sixth grade examination? Could you help her? I think yes. But before going on, what you suggest as others' assessment mechanisms, let me discuss with you the meaning of assessment. Assessment or educational assessment is a systematic process of documenting and using empirical data on the knowledge, skill, attitudes and belief to refine programs and improve students' learning. Now the question arises, what should we really assess? Along with, should we assess what the child does not know or cannot do? Are there other ways of assessing, as the teacher was wondering about? Children's beside examination? Is reporting in terms of marks enough? Should we encourage children to complete for more marks? I think we need to respond that why the assessment should be made to have the answers of the questions asked in the earlier slide. When we answer why to assess, the assessment should be to find out what learning and changes are happening in the children. Assessment should also be done to identify the individual needs and requirements. Assessment should also be done to plan teaching learning process in a more suitable manner. Assessment should also be done to help the child understand about what she knows or can do. Assessment is also to be done to find out the extent of achievement of objectives. Assessment is also to be done to improve teaching learning process and to communicate the children's progress. Assessment should also be done to do away with the fear of assessment among children. Assessment should also be done to encourage and support children to learn together. Now, with why, there is another dimension which is associated with assessment, what to assess. We need to assess children's learning in different subject areas. We need to assess children's skills, interests, attitudes and motivation. We need to assess children's participation in social activities. We need to assess children's responses to different situations and opportunities both in and out of the schools. We need to assess children's participation in co-curricular activities. Now, the question comes, when to assess? The assessment should be continuous in nature, that is, it should be invariably formative along with the summative assessment. Continuous assessment implies maintaining a profile for each child. This is required to reflect upon, derive feedback, plan and implement measures so as to enhance children's learning. Thus, continuous assessment implies a cycle of learning and assessment which keeps on moving. Now, the question again comes, how to assess? What are the sources of data from where we can get information about student performance? How we can collect that data and how the interpretation of the data on children's performance can be interpreted? When we talk about the sources of data on children's performance, we can have children themselves as the source of data. Then we can have parents, child's friends, peer, classmates, community members, principals, headmaster, school records such as attendance register, etc., as potential sources of the data on children's performance. Then we can collect the data on children's performance by conducting tests, recording observation in diaries, assessing the child's work during activity, writing descriptive statements of child work, preparing a child's profile and portfolio of work, note of important changes which is happening in child. And as far as the interpretation is concerned, we can interpret the data so obtained through different mechanisms and applying of different methods. We can interpret them traditionally, that is, we can process them in terms of scores, or we can generate grades out of that data to communicate meaning out of the data. Now, what are the objectives of continuous and comprehensive evaluation? As the answer of what to assess, why to assess, when to assess and how to assess. The answer is, we need to assess continuously and comprehensively to have the data on the performance of the learner so that their performance or the learning outcome can be maximized. So, we need to understand that what are the objectives of that kind of evaluation, that is continuous and comprehensive evaluation. Continuous and comprehensive evaluation aims at making evaluation an integral part of teaching learning process, that is, whereby the teaching learning process is happening or going on, the evaluation is going side by side so as to communicate that what is happening, whether the teaching and learning is effective and efficient or not, so that the reasonable steps or the required steps could be taken on spot to improve the teaching learning and thereby the learning outcomes. Continuous and comprehensive evaluation also aims at evaluation as a tool of children's learning, using evaluation as a tool of children's learning. It also encourages self-learning and self-evaluation. Continuous and comprehensive evaluation aims at making sound judgments, unbiased judgments rather, decisions regarding learner's growth, learning process, learning pace, and learning activities. It also aims at doing away with examination-related anxiety, fear, trauma, stress, or phobia from learners. It also aims at strengthening the institution, that is the school, where the learning of students is taking place to evaluate at the place of interference by the external institution or the external examination. It means it aspires to give more authority to the institution or to the teacher of the student who is teaching the student or who is making the learning to happen. Then what are the areas under which the continuous and comprehensive evaluation should take place? There are three areas under which the continuous and comprehensive evaluation should take place. The first area is the curricular area. The second area is the other curricular area, such as performance in the subjects like art education, work education, physical education, etc. And the third area is of social personal qualities or SPQs. It means that if assessment is multidimensional, then there have to be different methods of assessment. Now, we need to answer, or we will try to discuss that how the evaluation in curricular areas happen as a multidimensional aspect or in multidimensional manner. The evaluation in curricular areas include the evaluation of all the school subjects. Evaluation needs to be continuous from the beginning of the academic session, including periodic assessment, that is the monthly, terminal and annual assessment. The evaluation or the purpose of assessment should be to reflect on the learning and the progress of the student. Now, moving further, subjects such as art education, health education and physical education and work education also focus on acquisition of practical experience and skill. Then theoretical knowledge, that's why they have been kept under the evaluation of other curricular areas, and the evaluation of other curricular areas required assessment of through observation during the performance of assigned activities inside and outside the classroom, leading to different kind of grades or generation of grades. Here is a rubric which would highlight or exemplify that how assessment in other curricular areas can be done by the teacher. In the first column, we have exhibiting, or we are exhibiting the name of the activity. In the second column, we are trying to locate the status of the resources available, whether these were adequate or not at the time of the activity when the children are performing. In the third column, we are trying to locate the status of parent support at the time of the activity or at the time of child's performance. And in the fourth column, we are trying to spot the difficulties which we have faced or the child has been facing while performing the task. Now, moving on, the assessment of socio-personal qualities. The assessment of socio-personal qualities requires the recognition by keeping the regular notes of the noteworthy event, situation and activities indicative of these qualities. Then the award of grades such as A, B, C, D, so on and so forth is done to label the student's behavior for a particular period. Then the school should decide periodicity of assessment, preferably 3 to 4 times in the academic session. This is again a schedule which shows that what should be the tools and techniques, periodicity and reporting for the assessment of socio-personal qualities in different areas or different kind of socio-personal qualities. The particular areas in which the SPQs are specified are cleanliness, truthfulness, cooperation, discipline, punctuality, emotional stability, environmental awareness, love for physical labor, respect towards superiors, appreciation, responsibility, leadership and honesty, so on and so forth. The list is not comprehensive. Then what kind of tools and techniques we can use to assess the insistence or instillation of socio-personal quality in the student? We can observe, we can interview them, we can use the checklist, and we can also make a profile of child's behavior. The periodicity of these activities or the assessment of these activities could be on day-to-day observation by the teacher, or 3 to 4 periodic assessment can also be done for looking at the instillation of socio-personal qualities amongst the student. Then, as far as the reporting is concerned, we can have direct grading once in every 3 to 4 months on SPQs. As far as the assessment methods or how of the assessment is concerned, choice of method is determined through the answer to the following question. What does it mean to learn social sciences? What we want to learn in social science? The second question which relates the choice of the method is, what kind of classroom interaction can enhance learning in a social science classroom? The third question which is associated with the choice of method is, what are the objectives of teaching social science? What we are aiming at actually? And the fourth question which is associated with the choice of method is, what kind of indicator help us to see if these objectives are being achieved and to assess the learning of every child? This is about the assessment indicators. So, the objective of teaching of social sciences, of learning of social sciences at upper primary level are to develop an understanding about the earth as the habitat of humankind and other forms of life, to initiate the learner into a study of his or her own region, state and country in the global context, to initiate the learner into a study of India's past and references to other parts of the world, to introduce the learner to the functioning and dynamics of social and political institution and processes of the country. So, we can say that the objective of learning of social sciences is nothing but to facilitate the interaction of a learner to his or her past, to his or her present, and to his or her future. Then what could be the method to assess the attainment of learning objective, which are so broad? I think these are development of assessment indicator, which is a very systematic method of assessing the learning objectives. Then we are having the alternate methods of learning, assessment of learning, such as picture, reading, children's drawing, field visit, portfolio assessment, rubrics for performance based assessment. Many more could be added to this list because this list is not exhaustive. To elaborate further on the method to assess attainment of learning objectives, we are having development of assessment indicators. Then we are having alternative assessment methods such as creative writing, acting, dancing, picture reading, children's drawing, field visit, portfolio assessment, rubrics for performance based assessment. Now, as far as the development of assessment indicators are concerned, we want children to learn social science by developing different kinds of skills, conceptual knowledge, feeling, and sensitiveness. We can draw a broad list of indicators for assessment which can help you to plan your learning tasks as a teacher. Each indicator consists of abilities that need to be developed in children. It means every indicator has a corresponding ability or a group of ability associated with it. What are assessment indicators? Assessment indicators at elementary stage, we should help students' abilities to develop along the following indicators. Assessment indicators are the parameters over which the assessment of a child is measured. It is corresponding to abilities, a single ability or different kind of ability or group of ability, which is related with each and every indicator. So, assessment of a child at elementary level in social sciences can be done on the following indicator. The first indicator is observation and recording. How a child is observing and recording the facts. The abilities corresponding to this indicator are reporting, narrating and drawing, picture reading, making picture, tables and map. Through these abilities or development of these abilities, we can understand that the child is observing and recording in an efficient manner. The second indicator is discussion. The abilities associated with discussions are listening, talking, expressing opinions, finding out from others. The third indicator is expression, and the abilities associated with it are drawing, body movement, creative writing, sculpting, etc. It means that in which manner and how the student is expressing or trying to express himself or herself or his or her learning. So, it could be in the form of drawing, in the form of body movement or kinesthetic movement, in terms of creating writing or writing on a paper, or in terms of making any piece of art. Fourth indicator is explanation. Explanation is associated with reasoning, making logical connection as abilities. The fifth indicator is classification, and classification is associated with categorizing, grouping, contrasting, and comparing. Classification is a very important indicator when we talk about learning and assessment of learning in social science, as it clarifies that what is the level of knowledge acquired by the student in the social science vis-a-vis different phenomena which he or she has acquired. Moving on, the sixth indicator, which is questioning, the abilities associated with this are expressing curiosity, critical thinking, developing questions. The seventh indicator is the indicator of analysis, and the abilities associated with these are predicting, making hypotheses, and inferences. The eighth indicator is experimentation, and the abilities associated with this indicator are improvising, making things, and doing experiments. The ninth indicator is concern for justice. It's a social value, and the abilities associated with this are sensitivity towards the disadvantaged or differently abled, showing concern for the environment or the context. The 10th indicator is cooperation, and the abilities associated with this are taking responsibility and initiative, sharing and working together. So, we can say that elaborated observation and assessment intervention required with respect to each of the assessment indicator and the abilities associated with. Variety of methods as per the nature of learning indicator to be used as a single method is not opt for assessing all the indicators. To sum up in this lesson, the basic purpose of the assessment is to improve teaching learning process and ultimately to gauge the extent to which the capabilities of learner have been developed. Well designed assessment and regular reporting provides learner with feedback and encourage them to learn further. They also serve to inform parents about the quality of learning and progress of their wards. This is not a means of encouraging competition among learner. A good assessment can become an integral part of the learning process and benefit both the learner themselves and the teachers by giving feedback. It is obvious that teachers use to observe the progress of their children regularly on informal basis. These informal informations or observations no doubt have immense implication for improving teaching learning process and thereby children's learning. There is, however, need for some assessment and evaluation to help teachers reflect upon the information collected about learners. Thus, assessment should be on daily basis as well as on intermittent basis. There is a widespread belief that social science merely transmits information. It is book centered and is required to be memorized for examination. This is mostly due to the facts that our current practice of evaluation of people's learning, particularly in social science, usually employ teacher-made and standardized tests using multiple choice or other objective type items. These evaluation practices are insufficient to be used to measure complex problem solving skills, divergent thinking, collaborative efforts among students and communication skills, etc. Hence, there is an urgent need to think of introducing innovative and alternative methods of assessment in our educational institution, under which in this lesson we have discussed in detail about the assessment indicators of learning in social science at upper primary level. Now, this is time to take home task for you. Study the objective of teaching social science at elementary stage and identify the abilities that needs to be developed in children at this stage. Meet you again in the next lesson. By then, thank you very much.